I'm excited to hear from the Word tonight, and I want to know what God has to say. I pray and trust that He's been speaking to you all week. How many have He's been speaking to you this week? Okay, well, the Lord's telling me to do this, so I'm just going to be submissive to what He's telling me to do, if I can stall for just a second. I know that there is somebody out there, because the Lord told me this, so I'm going to trust that He's right all the time. But I know that there's somebody out there that God has spoken to them this week, and they just want to share. And so I'm going to let you do this before I speak. I'm going to let you come up and share just something that God shared with you this week, maybe something that was impactful. Maybe you're right in the middle of something. You kind of had a breakthrough. And I know that not everybody's an extrovert like me that loves to share, but I just really feel like that someone is out there that really had a God moment this week and is just excited about what they learned and what the Lord shared with them. So if that's you, I want you to come on up and share that with the rest of the congregation, and don't be shy, because you might be the catalyst to be able to really impact somebody else's life. So, all right? Who is that? All right? Praise God. I'm hearing from the Lord. Yep. All right. Was it you? All right. He was trying to give somebody else a chance. Well, I know it's more than one, but I wanted to at least give one person a chance. So. Go ahead.
All right. I was in prayer the other day, and the Father led me to actually play the song Mighty Breath of God. And while I was just in prayer and in worship, he began to speak to my spirit. And he said, never mistake my breath for a storm in your life. And he said, sometimes it might look like it's a whirlwind or a tornado happening in your life, but what it is I'm breathing in your life, because I'm blowing everything that is not sturdy, that is not stable in your life, I'm blowing it out so that you can know what is for you. And as I kept praying, and the Father just had us, had me pray, and then I ended up calling Precious, and the Father started speaking some prophetic words then, and he said, never despise the process of what you're going through, no matter what it may look like. Never despise the process, because what God is doing, he's setting you up for something greater. So in the midst of the process, don't just seek his hand, you seek his face and you trust his hand. When we seek his hand, we then only seek what we can receive from God. But when we seek his face, we're seeking the benefits of having relationship with God. But when we seek his hand, or when we trust his hand, we say, God, I seek the benefits of the relationship, but I trust your hand enough to know that no matter what's happening in my life, you're still in control. So, no, I just want to encourage you all that no matter what's happening in your life, continue to seek the face of God, but continue to trust his hand at the same time, because he might be touching some things in your life. Mm-hmm. He might be moving some stuff around, but the great thing about it is he's God, so he knows what's best for you. Amen. So seek his face and trust his hand.
Amen. All right, let's go eat. That was a good message. Praise God. I love it when the Lord speaks, and sometimes it's always encouraging. Rarely ever get to sit in your position and hear the word of the Lord, and so that speaks to me for sure. And you know, I want to just say something else before we begin. Maybe I'll be one of those that will share kind of my own personal heart and the things that God's teaching me. You know, one of the things that I struggle with more than anything is sometimes the wires that come the vertical and then they turn towards the horizontal, meaning that junction box between the horizontal and the vertical is where normally, I don't think I'm alone, I think there's a lot of people that at that junction box where the vertical, meaning that relationship with God, meets the relationship with man, sometimes that those wires get frayed. Anybody else feel that way sometimes? That they're like, if it was just you and God on an island, oh, come on. I mean, we would be tan and just perfect in our walk, right? It's only when God drops someone else on the island that we're like, we want to play the game Survivor and kick them off the island. You know what I mean? And I understand that sometimes. And sometimes our wires get crossed. You know, even with my own mic tonight, maybe some of you had noticed, I really felt like I wanted to share a couple things during worship, and I couldn't share because my mic would not turn on. And I'm getting the sound guy is going, yeah, it's on, and I'm going, it ain't on, you know. And they found out that the wires were kind of crossed. The wires weren't connected all the way. There was a loose wire. How many times in our life is there a loose wire in our connection that people can't hear what we're saying because we have a loose wire or because they have a loose wire? In either case, there's loose wires. And sometimes we just need to admit it's not the sound guy's fault. It's the wire's fault. The wires are messed up. You know, every once in a while, me and Cheryl have a marital Bible study. And that's code name for argument. And this morning on Shabbat was the best time to have a marital Bible study because it's Shabbat, right? And so we decided that we were going to have a marital Bible study. And I had offended my wife in making some plans. Men, have you ever made this mistake of making plans and forgetting to ask your wife if it's okay? Like if she finds out through an email or something, right? Not good. And so I made one of those mistakes, and so I began to apologize for doing that. And I'm going down the road of I am going to apologize for doing this because I know that this was hurtful, and I know that I was being selfish, and I wasn't thinking clearly, and so on and so forth. But she was hearing it from a completely different perspective because what she needed to hear was not that I was apologetic about this. She needed to hear this over here. But I didn't know that she needed to hear this over here, so I'm going down this road thinking I'm a hero for doing the right thing. She thinks that I'm not a hero for not doing the right thing, but how do you apologize, men, for doing something you don't even know you did? And that's where the wires get crossed. And I think sometimes at the end of the day, what the beauty of the marital Bible study that we had and the conclusion was wonderful because we both realized that we're just not understanding each other. You ever feel like you get to a place where you don't understand each other or you don't understand God and frustration starts to ensue and you start saying, well, you don't understand me and I don't understand you. Well, that doesn't do you any good. What you need to understand is that if we don't understand, we need to start over and rewire the junction box. Let's start over from the beginning. Point one, this is where I'm coming from. Point two, this is where I'm coming from. And let each other go through that. And I believe that in relation, one of the things I learned today on Shabbat is that the way that everything kind of got resolved was she just said, this is where I'm coming from. Point one, point two, point three. And I realized that that's exactly how God works. We have this massive disconnect in our relationship with God, and so we don't understand why we're not blessed. We don't understand why we seem to not understand Him, and He doesn't seem to understand us, and our circumstances seem to be out of control and everything. And I'm telling you, it has nothing to do with either one of you understanding. It has to do with the fact that we don't know what is required. And in Christianity as a whole, I believe that we're walking in circles and wandering in the desert. And all we have to do is listen from His perspective. And here's how God speaks. Point one, you offended me here. Point two, this is what I want you to do. Point three, this is what I want you to do. And so what happens is when we throw out, I'm just speaking not to this congregation necessarily, but just generically, it just dawned on me that the reason why we're in the problems that we are in is because we refuse to go back and look at the points of contention that He has. And when we don't look at the points of contention, then what do? We always think we're right, right? All right, well, anyway, that's kind of what God was teaching me this day. Mainly that I'm mostly always wrong. Any other man out there feel like that? Just once you want to be right? I know they dare not even laugh at that, right? Not with your spouse sitting next to you, for sure. All right, well, let's begin at our Torah portion today. And today our Torah portion is Vayeshev. All right, we start off in Joseph's dreams, okay? So Joseph is the 11th born son of Jacob. He is the firstborn son of Rachel. His younger brother is Benjamin. They are blood brothers born by the same mother, Rachel. And Joseph has these incredible dreams. And so he comes to we start off in verse 1. It says, "Now Jacob dwelt in the land where his father was a stranger in the land of Canaan. This is the history of Yaakov. Joseph, being 17 years old, was feeding the flock with his brothers, and the lad was with the sons of Bilhah and the sons of Zilpah, his father's wives, and Joseph brought a bad report of them to his father. Now Israel loved Joseph more than all of his children because he was the son of his old age. Now this is an interesting, I want to stop right here, right off the bat. This is an interesting phrase in the Hebrew because it does not necessarily mean that it was his son, that he had a son in his old age. The way that the sages interpret this from the Hebrew script is that he's saying that this is a son that has my wisdom, that has my anointing. Because and you can kind of see that because he says this is a son because he was the son of his old age. What happens when you are old? You're supposed to gain wisdom. And so Jacob loved Joseph more than any of his other children because he had a resemblance of him. He saw the anointing on Joseph's life. And remember, his father is who? Isaac. Who has the anointing? Isaac. From who did the anointing or the promise come? To Isaac, that your children would be as the stars of the sea and the sands, or the stars of the sky and the sands on the seashore. And so he understands that there is a patriarchal anointing that's going to be passed down from generation to generation. So if you were that close to an anointing where your father, literally your father, was the one that was about to be sacrificed on Mount Moriah by your grandfather Abraham, this would not be a story to you. This would be very, very serious if the living God of the universe showed up to your grandfather, just that close to you, your grandfather, and said, "This is what I'm going to do for your progeny." Don't think that this is not in the back of Jacob's mind as he has all of these children, both sons and daughters, that he's wondering, how is the anointing going to be passed? Who is it going to? He's already seen that it can pass from the firstborn to go to the secondborn. So he's wondering, how is this all going to work out? Joseph is the one he has his eyes on. And I believe for two reasons. I believe that number one, it's because his firstborn Rachel, and that's the one that he originally wanted to marry. Remember that? He goes to Uncle Laban's house, works for 7 years because he fell in love with Rachel. He gets tricked, has to marry Leah, and then works another 7 years to pay off Rachel, if you will. And so that firstborn son to Rachel is the most important to him, not to mention it is the seed from which the lineage or the inheritance is going to be passed. So there is a very special thing that he sees in Joseph's mind. And I believe that he sees an anointing. And this anointing shows up in the dreams that we're about to get into. So he makes him a tunic of colors. But when his brothers saw that their father loved him more than all his brothers, they hated him and could not speak peaceably to him. There's so much to get into. But let me just point this out. You would think that Jacob would have not made this mistake of playing favorites. Why? Because he saw his father do the exact same thing with his brother Esau. Remember this, that Isaac loved Esau more than he loved Jacob because of Esau's talent and his skill of hunting and his food. And so Isaac, this generational curse of playing favorites, finds itself in Jacob now. And now Jacob is playing favorites, and it's destroying the family again. Jealousy and playing favorites with children or with people destroys families. That's not how we're supposed to operate as believers. So now Joseph has a dream, and he tells it to his brothers, and they halted him even more. They hated him even more. So he said to them, "Please hear this dream which I've dreamed. There we were binding sheaves in the field. Then behold, my sheaf arose and also stood upright. And indeed, your sheaf stood all around and bowed down to my sheaf." His brother said to him, "Shall you indeed reign over us? Or shall you indeed have dominion over us?" So they hated him even more for his dreams and for his words. Now Joseph is not a not smart guy. We know this later in his life. He is a very brilliant man, okay? So even at 17, even though he's young, and what happens in the teenage years is pride, can go with before the fall. And so we are seeing, I don't necessarily believe, a lack of wisdom per se, as much as I do see pride. Is that his brothers are always putting him down, always making fun of him, always upset with him and hated him because of the favoritism that he had with his father. So naturally, this is not a lack of wisdom. He knows exactly what he's doing. See, the difference between wisdom and a lack of wisdom is a lack of wisdom says he knows what he's doing, he doesn't really know what he's doing when he's doing that. I believe Joseph knows exactly what he's doing. He knows that this dream is going to offend his brothers. He doesn't care. He wants to shove it in their face because of the animosity that they have towards him. It basically, it's, look, you guys treat me like crud all the time. I want you to know something. You're going to be bowing to me. I had a dream last night. And I believe that's exactly what's going on. How do we know that? Because he tells them this dream about the sheaves, and they respond negatively. Wisdom would say, I probably shouldn't do that again. Nope. Joseph says this. He dreamed another dream, and he told his brothers again and said, look, I've dreamed another dream. You guys are going to be excited about this. This time, the sun, the moon, and the 11 stars bowed down to me. And by the way, before I go any further, I want to give you a little historical context on the sheaves and the Hebrew tradition of the sheaves. If there were sheaves, okay, that all the sheaves were supposed to be cut at the same height, there was a tradition that if there was a sheaf that was a higher, that was had greater height than all the rest of them, they were supposed to, the workers of the field would stop what they're doing, carry that sheaf back to the master as a representation of greater growth. So there was a, this was far deeper than just their sheaves bowing down to his. His sheaf was taller. And so there was a recognition there that they were not only going to bow down, but they were going to have to exalt him and lift him up, okay? So it was extremely offensive to them that he was recognizing himself this way. All right, so back to the 11 stars. The sun, the moon, and the 11 stars bowed down to me. So he told it to his father and his brothers. And his father rebuked him and said, what is this dream that you have dreamed? Shall your mother and I and your brothers indeed come down to bow down to the earth before you? Now remember, Rachel is already passed because she died at the birth of Benjamin. And his brothers envied him, but his father kept the matter in mind. So what's happening here? Even Jacob gets a little bit offended. And then what happens? How do we know what's going on inside of Jacob's mind? There's one single verse that tells us that Jacob is remembering the promise. He's remembering the words of the living God because he says his brothers envied him, but his father, even though he had rebuked him, kept the matter in mind. Now, this tells us that Jacob, in the process of rebuking him, knew exactly what he was saying was true. In the process of rebuking his youngest son, or his 11th born son, he knew the whole time that what he was saying was from God. He knew it was true. He was doing this to save face for his brothers and his wife. In a way, he's playing sides, but he's actually playing both sides, which sounds just like Jacob, doesn't it? So then his brothers went to feed their father's flock in Shechem. Israel said to Joseph, are not your brothers feeding the flock in Shechem? Come, I will send you to them. So he said, here I am. Then he said to him, please go and see if it is well with your brothers and well with the flocks and bring back word to me. So he sent him out of the valley of Hebron and went to Shechem. Now a certain man found him, and there he was wandering in the field. What are you seeking? So he said, I'm seeking my brothers. Please tell me where they are feeding their flocks. The man said, they have departed from here, for I heard them say, let us go to Dothan. So Joseph went after his brothers and found them in Dothan. Now when they saw him afar off, even before he came near to them, they conspired against him to kill him. Then they said to one another, look, this dreamer is coming. Come, therefore, let us now kill him, cast him into some pit, and we shall say, some wild beast has devoured him. We shall see what becomes of his dreams. Now, before we go any further, I want you to start seeing some prophetic connections that this story is very messianic. This is very, very messianic. Most of the book of Genesis, actually most of the book of all the Torah, has got Yeshua built into everything. That's why when Yeshua was giving the Lazarus and the rich man story, remember the rich man ends up in Sheol, in Hades there, and he says, look, I need to go back to my brothers. I need to tell them about this terrible place and that you're actually the Messiah. And Yeshua says, look, it doesn't matter if a man raises from the dead and tells, if they don't hear it from the prophets or from Moses, they're not going to hear it from a dead guy because Moses wrote about me. And so right there, Yeshua tells us that he is written into the Torah, and it is everywhere. It's a matter of seeing it. And so what we see here is we see not only a picture of Joseph, who is the foreshadowing of the Christ himself, but he's also a picture and a foreshadowing of the northern house of Israel and how the northern house of Israel is going to be rejected by the southern house of Israel and how there's going to be enmity between the two, but eventually there's going to be restoration. So the story of Joseph is all about how all of Israel, goes back to identity crisis, which I taught last week, all the house of Israel, all 12 tribes, eventually would be split in their hatred for one another. One would be in the north, one would be in the south. There would be a wall of separation between them. That's what we're going to see. But eventually we're going to see this beautiful transformation and this restoration. So then what happens is we come to verse 21. But Reuben, who's Reuben? Firstborn son, okay? You have to understand the firstborn sons have incredible responsibility in Israel, in the inheritance. Everything that happened, they're the captain of the ship, they're going to be held responsible for. That's the way it worked. It was different in these days where every man is held accountable for their own works, that if the firstborn son is there, well, let's just read the story before I get into that. Reuben says, let's not kill him. Reuben said to them, shed no blood, but cast him into this pit, which is in the wilderness, and do not lay a hand on him, that he might deliver him out of their hands and bring him back to his father later. So that's what's in his mind. He's like, look, we can't kill him. I'm here with you. If you guys kill him and I'm here with you, I'm going to be the one that's held responsible. They're not going to come to you, Judah. Dad's going to come to me. I'm the one. My entire inheritance is on the line right here. I cannot commit murder. I will be forfeiting the inheritance. So Reuben is thinking about all of this. So he jumps up and says, let's not kill him. Let's just throw him into the pit. Now, his mindset was, I'm going to go back later and pick him out of the pit. So it come to pass when Joseph had come to his brothers that they stripped Joseph of his tunic, the tunic of many colors that was on him. Then he took him and cast him into a pit. And it was the pit that was empty. Same thing that happened to Yeshua. They stripped him of his coat of many colors because Yeshua came for the whole world. And he was a king, wasn't just a dreamer, but he was an anointed king. He was thrown into the pit, if you will, or hell, or Sheol, and there was no water in it. They sat down to eat a meal. Then they lifted their eyes and looked, and there was a company of Ishmaelites coming from Gilead with their camels, bearing spices, balm, and myrrh, and on their way to carry them down to Egypt. I thought that's interesting. It's Ishmaelites. So now we're back to Uncle Ishmael. So Judah said to his brothers, what profit is it if we kill our brother and conceal his blood? Come, let us sell him to the Ishmaelites, and let not our hand be upon him, for he is our brother and our flesh. And his brothers listened. Then the Midianite traders passed by, so the brothers pulled Joseph up and lifted him out of the pit and sold him to the Ishmaelites for 20 shekels of silver. And they took Joseph to Egypt. Now, what's really interesting about this is there's so much connection between this story and the actual leading up to the death, burial, and resurrection of Yeshua. Because what's happening is this. If you move forward, did Yeshua get sold? For how much? 30 pieces. Well, man, that would be really cool if it was 30 pieces, wouldn't it? Until you find out that in the New Testament, the price for slaves was 30 pieces of silver. back it up to here, and the price for slaves was 20 pieces of silver. So it's the same thing. He's selling him for the price of a slave. Exactly. And are they not his brothers? Is not one of them betraying him now? And the rest go along. So then Reuben returned to the pit. So Reuben's not there at this point. So Judah takes an interesting turn here. He waits till the firstborn is done because you know what? Reuben's standing in the way. I mean, the firstborn is always the one that seems to be either doing the right thing or doing the wrong thing or being in everybody's way and aggravating the rest of the brothers. So Reuben obviously is out having a Reuben sandwich or something. And Judah decides to take advantage of this and sell Joseph while he's gone. So Reuben returns to the pit to go get Joseph, has no idea what's going on, and indeed, Joseph's not in the pit. So he tears his clothes. He's freaking out. He returns to his brother and says, "The lad is no more. Where shall I go?" In other words, I'm not going to be able to hide from Dad. So they took Joseph's tunic, killed a kid of the goats, dipped the tunic in the blood. Then they sent the tunic of many colors, and they brought it to their father and said, "We have found this. Do you know whether it's your son's tunic or not?" And he recognized it and said, "It's my son's tunic. A wild beast has devoured him. Without a doubt, Joseph is torn to pieces." This is an incredibly prophetic phrase in this scripture. Why is that? I wish I had time to make a long PowerPoint on this to show you all the scriptures, but you can look it up for yourself. But there are scriptures where it talks about the northern house of Israel is basically torn by wild beasts. They are scattered into the four corners of the earth, and the wild beasts have devoured her up. This is what it's talking about. This is a prophetic foreshadowing of what's going to happen to the northern house of Israel. They're going to be destroyed, completely assimilated, if you will. And it appears as if he's dead. There's an appearance as the northern house of Israel is dead, even to this day. So Jacob tears his clothes, puts on sackcloth on his waist, and mourns for his son many days. And all of his sons and his daughters arose to comfort him, but he refused to be comforted. And he said, "For I shall go down to the grave, my son, in mourning." Thus his father wept for him. Now the Midianites had sold him in Egypt to Potiphar. He's a hot commodity. He just keeps getting sold. An officer of Pharaoh and a captain of the guard. And this is where everything shifts. In one of the most bizarre timeline historical contexts of the Bible that the Bible has to offer is we go from this story of Joseph being thrown in the pit, being pulled out, being sold to the Ishmaelites, now being sold to Potiphar, and all of a sudden between 37 and 39, we have a completely different topic that we are going to be transitioning off into of Judah and Tamar in chapter 38. So let's talk about this Judah and Tamar passage and find out what's going to happen here. By the way, before I go into chapter 38, there is something that you have to know about. There's a law in the Bible, in the Torah, that prohibits a man from selling his family member. So if a man sells a family member, in other words, if he kidnaps a family member and then sells that family member into slavery, he is to be killed. That is the law. So this is how serious this is that the sons of Jacob are actually plotting to first kill, then they plot to kidnap and sell into slavery. By law, they are going to be committed to death. They just don't know that yet. So now we take this turn. Chapter 38, follow along with me. It came to pass at that time that Judah departed from his brothers and visited a certain Adullamite whose name was Hirah. And Judah saw there a daughter of a certain Canaanite. Now there are other versions that say that Judah was being looked down upon by his brothers, specifically because it was him that was driving this killing Joseph, selling Joseph deal. So eventually, the text seems to imply in the original Hebrew that Judah is starting to pay for his anger and his sins. even from his other brothers, treating him the way that he treated Joseph. So Judah saw the daughter of a certain Canaanite whose name was Shua, and he married her and went into her. Time out, we've got a problem here. Because let's back up to Deuteronomy chapter 7, verse 14, or verse 1 through 4. When Yahweh your God brings you into the land you are entering to possess and drives you out before many of the nations, the Hittites, the Girgashites, the Amorites, the Canaanites, the Perizzites, the Hivites, and the Jebusites, do not intermarry with them. Do not give your daughters to their sons to take their daughters for your sons, for they will turn your sons away from following me to serve other gods, and Yahweh's anger will burn against you and will quickly destroy you. What is this? We've got Abraham getting instructions from God saying, do not. Fine. Remember, Abraham tells his servant, do not go to the Canaanites and take a wife. Go to where? My household, and take a wife for my son Isaac. Now, we're not even two generations removed. We're now one generation removed because Abraham tells that to his servant for Isaac, and now you've got Jacob, his son, taking a Canaanite wife. He knows this is against God's law. He knows that his grandfather has told him, don't do this. This is not good. But he does it anyway. And we're going to see the significant mistake that he makes is going to cost him incredible misery almost to his death. She conceives and bears a son, calls his name Ur. She conceived again and bore another son, calls his name Onan. She conceived yet again and bore a son and called his name Shelah. He was at Chezib when she bore him. So then Judah took a wife for Ur, his firstborn, and her name was Tamar. She's actually a Hebrew. She's an Israelite. I believe that that he realizes the seriousness of his sin of taking a Canaanite as the progeny for his wife. And so for the firstborn, he tries to make up for it and gives him an Israelite wife. But Judah's firstborn, was wicked in the sight of Yahweh, and the Lord killed him. Judah said to Onan, go into your brother's wife and marry her and raise up her for her, an heir for her, because you're her brother. Now, you have to understand that the rules of the Levirate marriage. So what happens is, and because this is an agriculture time period, and because that everything depended on the name and moving forth the last name and making sure that your tribe and your clan existed, God made up this law called the Levirate marriage, meaning that if your brother dies and leaves a widow, the next one in line is required to, and she has no son, you're required to go into her and give her a son. So that clan would now be in existence. So God was looking at it as a future of taking care of, if you will, the widows. She needs a son, or her clan is over with and she has no way to survive and there's no rights without that son. So it was an act of mercy, an act of grace. But here's the problem. Onan knew that the heir would not be his. So look at this. We got Onan here thinking exactly like his grandfather, Jacob, acting like his father, Judah, thinking nothing of anybody else but himself, because the first two die, right? His older brother dies. Who gets the inheritance? He does. So the last thing he wants to do is provide a son for his deceased brother's wife, because he knows that it will not be his lineage and it will resurrect the inheritance back to his brother. So this is a beautiful act of generosity, is it not? This is why God instituted that law, because it's not fair. The inheritance goes to the firstborn. So it protected other brothers from killing off the firstborn. You see how that would work? If that law doesn't exist, I wouldn't want to be a firstborn 4,000 years ago. Especially with 11 other brothers. Because especially if my dad is rich and wealthy beyond all compare, my life is at stake. So protecting the firstborn status, God made a law. Say, look, you kill off the firstborn, you're going to have to give her a son, and you're not going to get the inheritance anyway. So it removed the temptation 100%. So Onan doesn't want to do that. So it come to pass when he went into his brother's wife, he admitted on the ground, God didn't like that, off with his head. So Judah said to Tamar, I've got one more son, but he's not old enough to get married. His name is Shelah. Remain a widow in your father's house until he's old enough, and I'll give you him as a husband. Now, Judah's a bit nervous here. Why? Why is he nervous? He's down to his last son. Okay? This is like, you know, I don't know, playing some game, and you're down to your last roll. If you don't get this right, you're out of the game. If he loses his last son, there's no more Judah tribe ever. He's over with, done. So what is a natural human inclination to do when you have one left? Hold on to it. This is the mistake that a lot of us make in our walks with God and our walk with people, is when we get down to our last dollar, we want it for ourselves. This is what we do. This is our last dollar, my last jar of oil. The widow, what did she do in the New Testament with her last? She gave it, and God blessed her, right? What does God do? This is such an awesome story in so many respects, because God loves the last time, the last little moment, the last mite. He loves the last jar of oil. He loves the last minute on the clock before midnight, because it's at that moment he gets to show off his power if we let him. And he's down to his last son. And instead of doing the right thing, he decides to do the wrong thing. And watch what happens. So in the process of time, the daughter of Shua, Judah's wife, died. Now everybody's dying around Judah. His wife's dead. His sons are dead. He's got one son left and a daughter-in-law. And it was told to Tamar, saying, look, your father-in-law is going to Timnah to shear the sheep. So he took off. So she took off her widow's garments, covered herself with a veil, and wrapped herself, and sat in an open place. On the way to Timnah, for she saw that Shelah was grown, and she was not given to him as a wife. So when Judah saw her, he thought she was a harlot. Judah still doesn't have a holy bone in his body, because she covered her face. So he turned to her and said, please let me come into you, for he did not know that she was his daughter-in-law. So she said, what will you give me that you may come into me? And he said, I'll send a young goat from the flock. So she said, will you give me a pledge till you send it? He says, what should I give you? So she said, your signet and your cord and your staff that's in your hand. Now this is really interesting to me, because it's a kid, it's a goat, and she's asking for like everything. So this isn't like a one-to-one ratio of, hey, you're going to send me a goat, that's great. How do I know you're going to send me a goat? I'll leave you $5. No, I'm going to leave you my signet ring, my cord, and my staff. Now, this is off the charts prophetic, and it's not even funny, because Judah, we know, from his loins come the Messiah. Judah also represents the entire southern kingdom of Judah, which today we call the Jewish people, both the Messianic and the non-believing Jew. And what happens? We also know from the inheritance or the blessing that Jacob gives to Judah that he gets the kingly priestly blessing. The double material portion goes to Joseph. And so he's got the kingly priestly blessing. What is he giving over to this harlot? None other than the three major symbols of a king and a priest. He's giving over the signet ring, which is a signet, the ring is the seal of his name, his authority.
He's giving over the cord, which a lot of scholars will say is the cord that you actually wrap the offering in or the sheep in before it goes to slaughter. There's the priestly blessing. And also the staff, which is the entire authority of the existence of his tribe. Do you realize that? Remember when Moses, you know, calls the tribes, what do? They bring their each of the heads of the staffs. Heads of the tribes bring their staff. That is this is the banner of Judah, the banner of Naphtali. Are you kidding me? He is handing over to a prostitute the very existence of his entire tribe and hands it over to her. And I'd say, well, I'm not seeing the connection. Well, there's a couple incredible connections here that are to be made. First of all, we know that this happens in the first century. Turn with me to Romans chapter 11. As we see this turning over of the authority, remember the blessing or the prophecy was that Judah would hold the scepter until when? Till Shiloh comes. I don't have that scripture memorized off the top of my head as far as the reference verse, but it says that Judah is going to hold the staff until the Messiah comes, is what that means, until Shiloh comes. So we see a transfer of authority in the New Testament from the high priesthood that is in the form of man that is represented by the house of Judah, the Jewish people in the first century. Their grandpappy was Judah. Judah of the first century was holding the authority of both king and priest. When Yeshua died, that transfer of authority moved over. And we read that. And it says in verse 8, verse 7, "What then? Israel has not obtained what it seeks, but the elect have obtained it, and the rest were blinded. Just as it is written, God has given them a spirit of stupor, eyes they should not see and ears they should not hear to this very day." And David says, "Let their table become a snare and a trap, a stumbling block and a recompense to them. Let their eyes be darkened so that they do not see, and a bow down their back always. I say then, have they stumbled that they should fall? Certainly not. But through their fall, to provoke them to jealousy, salvation has come to the Gentiles. Now if their fall is riches for the world and their failure riches for the Gentiles, how much more their fullness?" So what happens is he says that if the natural branches of Judah are able to be broken off, how much, and the Gentiles be grafted in, how much more do the natural branches have the right to be grafted back in? So we see a concept, watch this, we see a concept that Judah of the first century, the rights and authority they transfer out of a lack of obedience and faith, they transfer to the Gentiles, who are called a harlot in the scriptures. The Gentiles are called, they hoard with the nations. So the northern house of Israel, which is the house of Joseph, whores among the nations. You learned this last week through identity crisis. And they become as Gentiles. So what happens is prophetically, Romans chapter 11 is connected to Genesis chapter 38 because Judah is about ready to hand over his authority, his anointing, his blessing, and the signet ring to the prostitute, the harlot, not knowing what's getting ready to happen. So now let's go back to Genesis chapter 38. And let's bring all this together. So in verse 20, so in verse 19, she arose and went away and laid aside her veil and put on the garments of her widowhood. So she went right back to her family and put her widowhood garments back on. Judah sent the young goat by the hand of his friend, the Adullamite, to receive his pledge from the woman's hand, but he did not find her. So the men ask around everywhere, where's the harlot who was open by the roadside? They said, there is no harlot in this place. What are you talking about? So he returned to Judah and said, I cannot find her. Also, the men of the place said, there is no harlot in this place. Then Judah said, let her take them for herself, lest we be shamed. For I sent this young goat, and you have not found her. And it came to pass about 3 months after that Judah was told, saying, Tamar, your daughter-in-law, has played the harlot. Furthermore, she is with child by harlotry. So 3 months down the road, she can't hold it in anymore. She's starting to show, and they see that she's pregnant, but she doesn't have a husband. So in their mind, she's a harlot. She's an adulteress. And what do you do with an adulteress? You stone her. She's history. She's going to be burned. So Judah said, bring her out and let her be burned. When she was brought out, she sent to her father-in-law, saying, by the man to whom these belong, I am with child. And she said, please determine who these are, and the signet, and the cord, and the staff. Two words that actually she was saying in the original Hebrew, you have to hear it, you have to see it. Check mate. No pun intended, I suppose. But Tamar is brilliant, because this was her plan all along, to make sure that the line, now this is what's beautiful about this picture. She is actually, because Judah, her father-in-law, is not following Yahweh and disobedient, she knows his line is going to die out. This is not incest, ladies and gentlemen, farthest from it. This is a woman who loves God and loves her father-in-law so much that she does not want to see the entire line of Judah and the tribe of Judah destroyed out of his own pride. She deceives him to protect him. And he doesn't even see it. And out of the deception, he actually wants to kill her. And doesn't even realize that from his loins are going to come the Messiah. So Judah acknowledged them and said, she has been more righteous than I, because I did not give her Shelah, my son. And he never knew her again. Now what's interesting about this passage just right here is that she could have came out with all of the people and all the family members that are left and all the servants to say, by the way, this is it right here. Whoever has this. She did not publicly humiliate him, which is what the human nature would want to do in a situation like that. To look, you've been put in jail. She's waiting her judgment. She knows she's going to die. You would think at that moment she would go public on the internet. You would think she would start up a Facebook page and post to save herself and to humiliate Judah. But she doesn't do that. She simply goes in private, sends word to him privately. Now here's why everything turns in Judah's life. If Judah was a politician, and we know this has happened many, probably a thousand times, but Judah's a politician and he has an affair with a woman, and the woman has the proof, decides not to go to CNN or Fox News or a news network, but to send him the proof privately, what do you think that man would do? Destroy the proof. Because at that point, there's no way that now it's her word against his. And he's the head of the clan. Judah is the head of the tribe. He receives this information privately, and at this point, he has a choice. And this is the same choice that every one of us get when we really mess up. God disciplines us over here, disciplines over here. We don't get it. Firstborn son dies, secondborn son dies, all these things, wife dies. You're just not getting it. And he finally brings it back in front of us again. Judah's given another opportunity to repent. And what does he do? He repents. In private, exactly the way the Torah says to do it. When you see that your brother's in sin, you're going to go in private. You don't go around them to the person that they offended. If you see that your brother's offended someone else, you go directly to your brother and let him do it. You don't go around him and say, hey, I could see that person offended you. No. That person may not even know that they're offended. So then what did you do? You created a relationship problem that didn't even exist. Tamar is righteous and she goes privately. Judah becomes righteous at this moment. He recognizes his sin. And he says, she's been more righteous than I. So then she gives birth and she gives birth to twins. So when it was giving birth, the one put out his hand and the midwife took a scarlet thread, bound it on his hand, saying, this one came out first. Then it happened as he drew back his hand that his brother unexpectedly came out. He says, how did you break through? How did you break through? Some of you don't know why I'm emphasizing that. His name, Perez, means breach. There's a breach. There's a breach. There's a breach. In other words, that Judah was going down this line and his line was disqualified from being the line of the Messiah because he had married a Canaanite out of the will of God. There was no way for his progeny to ever end up in the line of the Messiah because there was no conversion on her part. There was no heartfelt conversion to the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. This was a Canaanite woman who had pulled the heart of her husband aside. So what did God have to do? The wall had been put up between him and God. He was already feeling rejected from his brothers. He had already done terrible things and probably feeling phenomenally guilty for selling off his brother Joseph. Knows by law he's committed to death anyway. The walls have been put up and around his life. And what did God have to do? Had to literally go around him and create a breach in the wall. How many of us find ourselves walking with God and one day we know we make a mistake, we make another mistake, we make another mistake, and the next thing you know, we start building walls around ourselves because we're such a screw up, God would never want me. I'm condemned to death. All I do is I let down God. All I do is I'm building walls around myself. So you build walls higher and higher and higher and you're trying to keep God out of your life. I mean, that's an extreme example. Nope. People do this every day. And every one of us in different situations, we build even a small wall. So maybe your wall is you can't see over it. But sometimes in our life, people get to a place where they don't even want God in their life. And you know what's so awesome? God says, yeah, but I want you. And I'm going to work around you. And I'm going to show you the power of my love is that even in your sin, I am going to bring forth fruit from your loins. And even though your life, by your decisions, are miserable, and you are miserable because of your sin, from your life, I'm going to bring life to the world, even though you are not acting proper to me right now. Judah had no idea through his decisions. Yes, he was miserable. Half his family's dead. His wife is dead. He had made major mistakes. He just humiliated himself in front of his entire clan that was left that he slept with a prostitute. You're not supposed to do that either. And it ends up being Tamar. How humiliating. His daughter-in-law. And Perez is the one that ends up being the line. Now watch this. Turn with me to Ruth chapter 4. Those of you that have daughters should pay attention to this. You all know the story of Ruth and Boaz. Ruth is a Moabite. She's also not supposed to be a part of the deal. But Ruth has a conversion point with Naomi and says, I will follow you and your God will be my God. This is another example of Romans chapter 11 where someone who is a Gentile, a goy of the nations, she's actually a pagan Gentile. She has no Israelite lineage whatsoever and she has the right to be grafted into Israel and be one as a native born. One of the most beautiful pictures in the Bible. Don't let anybody tell you that a Gentile cannot be part of Israel. When Ruth, one of the mothers of Israel, is a Gentile. But watch what happens here. If I can find this here real quick. Yes, okay, here it is. In verse 11, it says, "And all the people who were with them at the gate," this is at the point where Boaz is about to marry Ruth. It's a beautiful, beautiful pinnacle of the story. "We are witnesses. Yahweh, make the woman who is coming to your house like Rachel and Leah." That's pretty common. Every Jewish patriarch says that to his daughters. "May you be like Rachel and Leah." Every Shabbat, they say that. But then watch this. "The two who built the house of Israel, and may you prosper in Ephratah," Bethlehem Ephratah, by the way, "and be famous in Bethlehem." This happens in Bethlehem. "May your house be like the house of Perez, whom Tamar bore to Judah because of the offspring which the Lord will give you from this young woman." Out of all the women in ancient Israel, they are comparing and putting a blessing on Ruth and Boaz that your children will be like the house of Perez. That's how anointed this story is, my friends, that the story of Perez or the story of Judah and Tamar is connected to the story of the Messiah, the messianic lineage. Now, let's bring this together to show you another prophetic connection of why Judah, when he hands over the blessing to Tamar, what we see is Tamar in the story does what? He hands over his signet ring, his cord, and his staff, everything of his identity. And it seems to be lost forever. What does Tamar do? She brings it back. So we should see a prophetic connection that at the very place that we believe that Judah is going to be gone and over with, that it actually comes back. And we see that, as I mentioned in Romans chapter 11, it says that branches are broken off so the Gentiles could come in, and then guess what happens? The Gentiles take over the role of the authority and the ministering power because of the Messiah is the one that is holding that stick now. And the Gentiles end up being a light to the nations and end up witnessing to the house of Israel, and Judah ends up coming to Messiah. Watch this. In Leviticus chapter 21, verse 10, it says this, "He who is the high priest among the brethren, who has his head anointing with oil, was poured, and who is consecrated to wear the garment, shall not uncover his head nor tear his clothes." In other words, if you are a high priest and you tear your clothes in anger, you are immediately disqualified from being high priest. You cannot be high priest. So now, we move to Matthew chapter 26, verse 62, and this is the night before Yeshua dies. "And the high priest arose and said to him, 'Do you answer nothing? What is it that these men testify against you?' But Yeshua kept silent. And the high priest answered and said to him, 'I put you under oath by the living God. Tell us if you are the Christ, the Son of God.' So Yeshua said to him, 'It is as you said. Nevertheless, I say to you, hereafter you will see the Son of Man sitting at the right hand of the power and the coming in the clouds of heaven.'" It was probably not the right thing to say at midnight to the high priest. But the high priest then tore his clothes, saying, "He has spoken blasphemy." According to the Torah, the moment that Caiaphas the high priest tore his clothes, he is immediately disqualified from being high priest. Now, this is where it gets really interesting and very cool, I believe. As you come to John 19, in verse 22, Pilate answered. First of all, what did they put on Yeshua when they scourged him after that? They put on a robe, a purple robe. And a purple robe is what? It is a king's ephod. It is a high priest ephod. And did you know that the high priest and the king wore a tunic that was seamless. It was woven from top to bottom. There was no seams in it. Do you know why? To prevent it from ever being torn. Because if it tears, you're disqualified. So you make it really difficult to tear by not creating a seam at all. Do you follow me? Okay, John 19, 22, Pilate answered and says, "What I have written, I have written." So he gives his decree. Then the soldiers, when they had crucified Jesus, took his garments and made four parts, to each soldier a part, and also the tunic, this royal robe. Now the tunic was without seam, woven from the top to the bottom in one piece. They said therefore among themselves, "Let us not tear it, but cast lots for it." That's a pretty good looking garment they're looking at. Who gets to see a high priest's garment every day and gets to own it? To see whose it shall be, that the scripture might be fulfilled, which says, "They divided my garments among them, and for my clothing they cast lots." Therefore the soldiers did these things. In a nutshell, ladies and gentlemen, what's happening in this little story right here, which is connected, I believe, to the story of Judah and Tamar, is that the high priest Caiaphas tears his clothes and eliminates and disqualifies himself from being the high priest. But Yeshua is in that night given a robe of the high priest, and it doesn't get torn. He is the new legitimate high priest. The high priesthood is transferred from Judah to one that is from Melchizedek, from beyond, from the other side, the Hebrew, the one who has crossed over from death to life. Then what happens is that scepter that Yeshua takes is given then to, if you will, the Gentiles, the ones that believe through faith. From the Gentiles, this is prophetically what's going to happen. We see this in Romans chapter 9, is that and following even Romans chapter 11, that all Israel is going to be saved, because they're going to take the very light that Judah was supposed to have to the Gentiles are going to take it back to Judah. And all of the house of Israel will be one. Does that make sense? Amen. So let's go back to Genesis and we'll finish this up. So now you have this story of Joseph. Remember, we were talking about Joseph. Like, how on earth do we get talking about Judah and Tamar? So we go to Joseph, who's been thrown into a pit and sold into slavery. Now he's a slave in Egypt. He's under Potiphar's house. Potiphar's wife comes up to him wanting to have an adulterous affair. Seeing a connection. Joseph does what? The opposite of what his father did, what his brother did, and he flees. Right there, he tells us, even in the scriptures in the New Testament, says to flee sexual immorality. So I want to just do a little rabbit trail before I come back to this main topic here and say this. Nope, Holy Spirit's telling me to finish this thought so I don't lose all of you. All right. So we see the connection. There's a massive connection of why this story seems to be out of place in chapter 38 between the putting him in the pit and selling him off to the Ishmaelites, eventually into Potiphar's house. And then all of a sudden now we pick up the story with Joseph again, and it ends up being that Joseph is in Egypt for, do you know how many years go by before he gets to see Jacob, his father, again? He leaves at 17. 22 years. Now, that might not be significant to you until I tell you this next part. Do you know how long it was when Jacob disobeyed his dad, deceived his dad, left his dad before he had restoration with his brother? 22 years. Jacob deceived his father Isaac, stole the birthright, stole the blessing, and literally his mother said, "Get out of Dodge, your brother's going to kill you." He was banned from the family, lost his father, lost his mother for 22 years. And then he had restoration with his brother. And thus the family. So God, because of that deception, see, Galatians chapter 6 says this, God is not mocked. Whatever a man, he shall also reap. Whatever man sows, he shall also reap. So you sow in evil, don't think you're going to get away with it. Don't think, well, I'm just going to go out and sin for a little while. God will forgive me. God is not mocked. Every decision you make will come back to you. If you sow discord, discord will come to your house. You sow peace, peace will come to your house. Sometimes it doesn't happen right away. Sometimes it takes 22 years. And so he sowed a lie. He sowed deception into his father's house. And you know what happened? His own sons would deceive him, and he would be prevented from seeing his son for 22 years. But I still haven't made a connection to Judah and Tamar and how that whole thing happens. Because what happens with Joseph? He's totally disguised, is he not? So he's in Egypt. All of a sudden there is this drought, a famine in the land, and his brothers have to come up. Benjamin comes up, and he wants so badly to reveal himself to his brothers. Because he gets over and he realized it was the will of God this whole time, that God had used this in his life drastically. He's now second in command. The connection is this, is that Joseph is also just like Tamar. He is covered and veiled, and his brothers have no idea who he is. But they are coming to Egypt for life. They're coming to Egypt to get food and sustenance for themselves. In the process, what happens? Joseph is revealed to them, and Joseph restores the brothers and his father to their rightful inheritance, and they get the entire land of Goshen in the process. Now, that may not be significant to you, but from that restoration, which is, I believe, why Judah and Tamar are right there in that story, right in sandwiched in the story of Joseph, because it is the story of Joseph and his brothers. Judah is deceived by Tamar, and in the process, the lineage of the deception protected his life. Same thing with Joseph. Joseph deceives his brothers because the veil is over their eyes. They can't recognize him because he walks, talks, and looks like an Egyptian. He's a Gentile, if you will. And in the process of being a Gentile, they don't realize that they're about to die. Their lineage and all the tribes are about to fail and go into oblivion. And because of the very deception that Joseph is doing, he saves their lives and all of Israel. You see, here's the prophetic story, what's so deep, and I know that some of this is hitting you right here about the eyebrow. And maybe I'm not being articulate enough to let you get it, to help you get it, because I'm hardly grasping it myself because there's so much stuff here. But the power behind this is that Ephraim, the northern house of Israel, the 10 tribes in the north, are scattered throughout the four corners of the earth. And from the perspective of Hasatan, God is dead. The lineage of the tribes is dead. Revelation can't come true with the 12,000 from each tribe. It can't happen. But God said, what is dead, I will call forth. He calls forth to the four corners of the earth, and all the rest of the tribes, if you will, of Judah, believe that Ephraim is dead. He's not dead. They sold us. We're simply Egyptian. Not realizing that in our Egyptian status, God would actually call us to save the rest of Israel. You see, Hasatan, if we were all, listen, this is how awesome God is. If we were all blood tribes, if every one of us knew the exact tribe, you knew it was pure. I'm Dan, I'm Naphtali, I'm Asher, I'm Gad, whatever. Hasatan could easily wipe us out. But the moment that God allowed the tribes to be spread into the four corners of the earth and they eventually would lose their identity, guess what happens? Hasatan can't figure out who we are. Because he took it out of the earth realm and put it into the spiritual realm. and said, now you're not a bloodline child of God. You are a spiritual child of God. You are from above. And what is from above, what's below can't steal. This is why in the New Testament it says, I believe in the book of James, that nothing can separate you from the love of God. A Canaanite, a parasite, a Jebusite, it doesn't matter what they are. Hasatan himself cannot track you down because you are born from above, and what's born from above cannot be destroyed from what's below. This is the beautiful story of the gospel. Yes, you can give the Lord a hand. At the end of the day, the story is all about broken people not following God. And God says, I see beyond you. I see past your sin. I see what I want you to be, what you can be. I see you greater than you see yourself. Judah didn't see the power of what was coming after him. And I'll close with this. Turn with me to Matthew chapter 1. I love, you know, how many have watched all the Rocky movies back in the day? I think they're making like a Rocky 22 or something. You know, Rocky gets up there in a wheelchair, you know, and don't make me hit you. I don't know. But you know why everybody loved the Rocky movies back in the 80s? Because Rocky was the underdog. Always the underdog. Do you know that Yahweh loves underdogs? He takes the foolishness of the world and confounds the wise. I love the fact. You know, one of the things that atheists poke at? They poke at and people that, even people that believe in God, that say Jesus can't be the Messiah because look at his lineage, it's all screwed up. I love the fact that the lineage of the Messiah is not perfect because it gives all of us hope. Read with me in Matthew chapter 1. The book of the genealogy of Jesus Christ, the son of David, the son of Abraham. Abraham begot Isaac. Isaac begot Jacob. Jacob begot Judah and his brothers. Judah begot Perez. There you go. And Zerah by Tamar. Perez begot Hezron, and Hezron begot Ram. That'd be a cool name. Ram. Talk about speaking things into your kid's life, right? Ram begot Amminadab. Amminadab begot Nashon, and Nashon begot Solomon. Solomon begot Boaz by Rahab. Boaz begot Obed by Ruth. Obed begot Jesse, and Jesse begot David the king. David, the king, begot Solomon by her who had been the wife of Uriah. And who was that? Bathsheba. Okay, so here's what I want to point out of why I believe this thing is so beautiful. Is that not a single female is mentioned in this genealogy except for four. And all four of those are not supposed to be there. Not a single righteous female is mentioned from the lineage of Israel, but four that are not supposed to even be there are in there. Let's go through them real quickly. So Judah, in verse 3, beget Perez and Zerah by Tamar. So Tamar is pointed out as part of the lineage of the Messiah. She is one of the matriarchs. There's four matriarchs. I mean, oh my goodness. We could have mentioned, you know, Rachel would have been a good one to mention. She doesn't even get mentioned. But Tamar, he picks the righteous. Tamar is a righteous woman, and she gets picked to be in there. Then who else do we have? We've got Solomon beget Boaz. By who? Ruth. I mean, excuse me, by Rahab. Who's Rahab? None other than a prostitute in Jericho. But she gives them, she saves their life, does she not? She saves all of Israel in that story. Go back and read it. She saves all of Israel. One prostitute saved the entire nation of Israel. Don't tell me that God doesn't use the lowest and the foolish to confound the wise. Did not Tamar, the prostitute, save all of Judah? And in the process, save all of Israel because the loins of the Messiah would come from him. Next, we have Ruth. Come on! As my friend Greg would say. Greg, give us one. Where's he at? I'll do it for him. Come on! I knew he's not in here. I hadn't heard one all night. And then we got Precious. Amen! Come on, give me one over there. There we go! But you've got Ruth, who's a Moabite, who doesn't even belong in this story. She knows she doesn't belong, but she loves. She loves the people of God so much she wants to serve the Lord God with all of her heart, mind, soul, and strength. So she gives her heart to Yahweh, and from a Moabite, a Gentile of Gentiles, comes one of the most righteous women in all of Scriptures. And you know, from Ruth comes Obed, who begets Jesse, who is the father of King David. Come on! I love that God picks the underdogs. And you right now may feel like an underdog. You may feel like you've blown it. You may feel like God doesn't love you. God doesn't care. God's not even looking in your direction. I'm here to tell you that you can't get more messed up than some of these people. Laying with prostitutes. Giving away your entire inheritance of all of your tribe, only thinking about you. God says, turn to me and I will make you fisher of men. Turn back to me and I will turn back to you. For I have never turned my back on you to begin with. My face is constantly shining in your direction. If you turn around, you'll see my face. I love you. I gave myself up for you. It's never too late for me to restore your name. And ultimately, my name through you. Lastly, some of you in this house, I mean generically, worldwide, in the house of God, feel like God is chastising you. Is disciplining you. Things are rough right now. I walked off the stage or was walking onto the stage and one of the worship team members I could tell was I just felt something. So I said, are you doing okay? And she said, you know, the growing, how'd she put it? She said, the growth process is tough sometimes. Anybody feel like the growth process is tough sometimes? So I want to tell you right now what's going on in Passion for Truth. God is growing us. Do you know what that means? Adversity. That means God is going to allow the enemy to attack a little bit. He's going to allow circumstances to happen in your life. Consider it pure joy. You're about to get promoted. It's an interview process. Everyone believes a lot of times that the enemy is just the bad guy. No, the enemy is in trouble. His eternal punishment, in my mind, this is what God has shown me, You get drawn into a torture chamber, and his job is to do what he does and prick you at your rib cage, and he takes out his right hand. He's got his sword, and he's just digging into you, and he's got one hand behind his back. And see, we get so focused on the sword, we don't even ask the question, what's behind his other back? Because what you don't know is there's a dark window. God is looking through that window, watching everything that happens, and he's got a shock collar on the enemy. And if you pass this test, he's required to give you what's behind his back. Because what you don't know is you're not the one being tortured. He's the one being tortured because God is forcing him to give you your promotion. Your promotion comes from the adversity in your life. No different than Joseph's promotion came from the qualification trials. The pit, Potiphar's wife, the prison sentence. It was all but one giant interview to see if he was worthy to be second in command. Who ends up being second command in the New Testament? Yeshua the Messiah. Sits at the right hand of the Father, second in command to the great Pharaoh himself, and he had to qualify all the way. He's the Son of Living God. Isn't that make him qualification? Nope. You are the Son of Living God, divine in origin, come in the human likeness of men. But God says, sorry, pal, you want to be like, I sent you to take the form of mankind, which means you have to do the same thing they do. You have to make sure you obey me at every point along the way. So I leave you with this. For those of you being pressed, understand that at your pressing, you better make the right choice. Because if you don't, you will disqualify yourself from the anointing and the promotion that God wants to give you, and you'll have to go all the way around. You don't want to wait for the next trial. Do you know why I love trials? The faster the trials come, the faster the promotion. The higher on the floor you get to go up to the principal's office. You get called in the principal's office, consider it pure joy. Praise God. I can't wait. God, I'm so happy that I see a wooden spoon in your hand. Oh, yes. And as you bow, you get spanked, and then you come back up and you praise the Lord. That's the way it's supposed to work in your walk with God. Give Him praise and glory no matter what He does, because He only disciplines those that He loves. Amen? I better stop before I say something dumb. Stand up to me, please. God is so good all the time. I want to hear everybody say it. God is good all the time. Amen. Yahweh loves you. He wants to keep you. Don't run out of His hand when He's disciplining you. I need some music. Somebody turn some music on. I'm just going to have Greg start singing back there. God knows right where you're at. Whatever your difficulty is, maybe you're frustrated with God. Maybe you're frustrated with men. Let me say it the way God tells me, because I'm kind of a blockhead and sometimes I don't get things. Just ask my wife. God has to be really direct. So maybe you're frustrated with God. Maybe you're frustrated with men. Get over it and get on with loving God and praising Him for wherever you're at. Why do you feel like that you have to be in control of your life? If something happens to you in your life that's unjust, did you know that the Word of God says He's required to fix it? Look at Tamar. It's perfect proof. She was totally treated with disrespect. Her progeny and the progeny of the whole tribe was going downhill. And the head of the tribe made a mistake. And God fixed it. And he humbled himself. Will you believe in God today? Believe in what He wants to do in your life. And lastly, this. There's 12 rounds. And the referee has not blown the whistle yet. Don't give up in what the Father wants to do in your life. Amen? Father, we come before you. We thank you so much that you never gave up on us. That when we were down and out, when we've made our mistakes, Lord, that you sent your only begotten Son that whoever believed in him, Jew, Gentile, didn't matter, they had the right to become children of God, and in so, take part in the inheritance. So, Father, I want to thank you for our patriarchs, even in their mistakes, that they made it. They passed the torch. The torch may have waned and the light may be dim. But I thank you that when that torch came to your son, that he held it high. He never compromised. He never put it down. He took punches in the chest, God, but he never let go of the torch. Father, would we be as such men and women as Tamar that would not take no for an answer, that would absolutely be more concerned about someone that's hurting us than about us ourselves. Father, let us let you do what you do best. Let us put men in your hands. Let us pray for our enemies and those that hurt us. And God, I thank you for the prophetic foreshadowing of your son through all of these stories. It's incredible to me, God. Let us be, Father, like Joseph in his latter years, that the test came when his brothers came before him. He could have destroyed them. He had the power to kill them. You had anointed him with the scepter, and he chose to forgive and to love. He chose to walk in the role and the anointing that you gave him and refuse to stoop to his right by law to kill them. He could have brought them before the court, God. They sold a brother into slavery, which is against your law that requires death. And he, as the benevolent son foreshadowing of your son, decided to pardon and bring life. God, today I pray you'd help us. And whoever's in our mind right now, in our hearts that have offended us, that we will decide life, grace, mercy, pardoning. Let us walk in the anointing of your son, who loved us, yet while we were still sinners, he died for us. Father, thank you for your word. Thank you for your worship. Thank you, God, for my wife, who never gives up on me. Father, I thank you for our spouses. Thank you for our children. And thank you, God, that you use imperfect people to accomplish your perfect will. And everyone said, amen.
If you were blessed by this teaching, please consider helping us reach the nations by making a donation today. Thank you, and God bless.